In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I must admit, I sort of like the idea of casting lots in order to find the will of God. I mean, pray really intently and cast lots, and you have a 50% chance of getting what you want, right? In fact, I remember hearing some advice once that if you're ever stuck between two decisions and you don't really know quite what you want, toss a coin, because in that split second when it's in the air, you know which side you want it to come down. So that means that you know your decision. Casting lots. If only it was that easy. I mean, think of how much shorter the vestry meetings would be. Cast lots. Of course, we have to remember that this picture that we have from the Book of Acts is probably the end of what was a long discussion. The church around the world has celebrated Ascension Day this past Thursday, when we observe, when we remember that Jesus went back into heaven and told the disciples to go into Jerusalem and wait there until the coming of the Holy Spirit. So we have here gathered about 120 people, men and women. Some are new, like Jesus' family, and then some have walked with him for a long time. As they gather to pray, they pull out their scripture, they remember the words of Jesus, and they talk among themselves, trying to figure this all out. One morning, someone realizes the significance of the 12 apostles and the 12 tribes of Israel. And 11 apostles just doesn't have that ring, you know? It wouldn't work. And so they decide, well, we have to have 12. I wonder how many names were put forward before they got down to 2. I wonder who was backing who. But there's something to be said about impersonalization of casting lots. The community agreed both men had qualifications that they wanted. They came together to ask God for direction and then cast lots. No politics, no personal agendas, just let God decide. Actually, it's quite interesting that Luke includes this story, because after Matthias became one of the 12, we don't hear from him again. I hope he did have an incredible ministry as an apostle. And I hope that Joseph, the one that wasn't chosen, also had continued his ministry of his testimony of who Jesus was. But from our perspective, looking back on history, one might argue that God had already chosen someone completely different. However, this person, at the time that they were casting lots, was actually just arriving in Jerusalem, a young Pharisee named Saul, who was zealous for being the best ever and wanting to learn from one of the great teachers, Gamaliel. However, we can still learn from Peter and the other believers in the upper room. Their criteria came out of a time of prayer. They moved forward the best way they knew, with the knowledge they had, so that the ministry of God would continue. And God still fulfilled God's plan in God's time. It wasn't standing at all in God's way. Stay in Jerusalem and wait for the Holy Spirit to come upon you. These are Jesus' parting words at the Ascension. And the disciples gathered together for the next 10 days. And when the day of Pentecost came, they had a much better understanding of God's vision for the world. The church has traditionally seen this time between Ascension at Pentecost, so from last Thursday until next Sunday, as a time to pray again, to gather and pray again for the work of the Holy Spirit in the world. And this year, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin Welby, is encouraging the church to once again to pray for a new awareness of the work of the Holy Spirit in the world. The Church of England has actually set up a global prayer event called Thy Kingdom Come, and we can all join in virtually if we want to. It's kind of cool to think in our modern world that we can connect Christians all over the world to be praying together at the same time. But even without technology, we're still connected in Christ. People all over the world will be praying this next week. And when God's people pray, amazing things happen. On a personal level, our church here at St. James also needs prayer at this time as we gather to choose a new leader. And I think it's rather symbolic. I know that it was just by chance, but it is symbolic that we are meeting the Saturday before Pentecost here, right before Pentecost, as a congregation to come together to talk with each other, to put the word into words, the vision we see for St. James, to build unity. Unity isn't easy. We all come from many different backgrounds, many cultures. We have differences of opinion, differences of temperament. Our one point of unity is that we have all chosen to worship here at St. James. And we love St. James, and we want it to continue to be a light in Austin and in the world. And that is why this Saturday is so important, so we can come together and listen to each other with respect, remembering that we are united in our love for St. James and united in Christ. We are united in our desire to see God's will accomplished in our church, in our city, and in our lives. And all this unity is obviously really important to Jesus. As we see from the gospel reading today, which Kyra, I thought, it sounds like Jesus is here praying. Her voice is just so wonderful. Jesus prayed for his disciples to have unity. And I believe that he continues to pray and will be praying for us in this today and throughout this week up to Saturday. And so I invite you to join this worldwide event and pray a few moments each day from now until Pentecost and hopefully beyond, but commit to at least Pentecost. Pray for our meeting on Saturday. Pray for the work of the Holy Spirit at St. James. Pray for the work of the Holy Spirit in the world. We pray both with humility and expectation. Humility because we don't know the will of God for absolutely sure. We can only walk by the light which we have and ask God to show us what we need to know. But expectation, because God is working in us and through us, and with God, anything is possible. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your people and kindle in us fire in your mouth.